address the town hall meeting audience. Thank you.
A very good afternoon to you, Preeti, distinguished parents of the Primary Years program, and Pooja Grover and her team of Corona Warriors. It's a great pleasure for me this afternoon to be speaking to you, and thereafter I would invite your comments, your suggestions or clarifications, so that we are all on the same page. While the primary faculty has already familiarized you with the core aspects of the IB curriculum and how it is being delivered there, I will focus this afternoon on the purpose of education at Indus and how it is shaping the leadership philosophy and how that leadership philosophy is going to help your child to succeed in a post-corona world. I speak to you with a lot of insight into the purpose of education and the new role of leadership which has emerged. But before I come to that, I just want to draw your attention to three major shifts that are taking place in education. And it has taken a corona to remind us about it. This shift happened when the fourth industrial revolution started at the beginning of this century. But then somehow we got so trapped and caught up in our day-to-day work that despite the fact that the message was written loud and clear in the blue skies above, I think because of the pollution effect in our country, we could not read the signals. These three shifts are happening as I speak to you now. The first shift is the teaching is now, so far, has been confined to teaching of the head. We focused on the head all these 500 years, or even more than 500 years. We focused on the economic man in providing education for a child to get a good job, to get a good slot in a good university, and have a decent career. It was pure economic purpose. It had no moral focus at all. That was incidental. We spoke of values, we spoke of character development, but there was no serious attempt at that in our education. So the shift, ladies and gentlemen, is the education of the heart and the mind and not the head alone. Education is shifting to competencies of the heart and the competencies of the mind. Google does a better job as far as competencies of the head are concerned than most human beings on the planet. And therefore, as a result of this, the role of the teacher is no longer to teach content. Some content, yes, like concept, like relevance, and maybe a few critical things in a particular unit. But essentially, she is now a competency teacher. And this is something which computers and AI cannot do, at least in the foreseeable future. In fact, if you look at the new laws which are emerging now, in the future of jobs, there's no point in training a child in acquiring a skill if computers can do it faster and better than them. And therefore, this whole idea of homeschooling is blown apart. Homeschooling had relevance when content was important, when passing examination was important. It is irrelevant, absolutely irrelevant. I cannot see most parents being able to develop competencies, especially innovative competencies, because competencies require teamwork. It's not an individual effort. To develop competencies, you got to be part of a team. You got to socialize. You got to work as a part of a network, a web of networks. You can't do it alone. So mom and dad at home cannot do it. Content they can, although content itself is now getting outdated, knowledge is getting outdated every 48 hours. Whatever content was being taught last year may not be relevant today. And the other thing in homeschooling is that the child has to be able to reskill herself. She has to have the competencies to reskill herself as she goes along. This can't be done in homeschooling. Rare. I would say the rarest of rare it would happen. Therefore, the first law, the first shift that has taken place, the role of the teacher is to teach the child and not the subject alone. That is the priority. To teach the child is to teach your child the competency she needs to be innovative. To teach the child means to provide an emotional and spiritual support. To teach the child means to give your child a purpose in life to seek and a vision to follow. Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest gift a teacher can give, a parent can give, is not love, it's not money, it is a vision. People will remember you for the vision they gave you. They will not remember you for having enabled you to get 100 or 100 in science and maths or get you an IIT slot or a Harvard or a Stanford slot. I think that is the very first big shift that has happened. Therefore, I'm saying Corona is a very good thing. Had Corona not happened, we would have continued our somnambulists. We would have been living in limbo with an artificial bubble around us. And the second thing which Corona has done, the big second shift is, it has redefined what leadership means. Purpose of education at Indus is the foundation of the philosophy of leadership here. Now we say in our purpose statement before the vision that the purpose of education at Indus is to prepare your child for a future we do not know. We have recalibrated that. We have refocused it, we have reimagined it, and the purpose of education at Indus is when your child graduates from the portals of Indus Pune, is to make your child future ready. To be future ready is to be startup ready. Your child should be able to start a startup the moment she graduates from our DP program. So instead of looking for jobs, seeking jobs, she should be giving jobs to people. That is the new format. How it is being done? It is being done by developing an entrepreneurial mind. I want to bring out the difference. All entrepreneurs are leaders. But very, very few leaders are entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs are innovators. They innovate products based on their empathetic connection with the customer. They make the world a better place. They heal and sort out a lot of wrong things that are happening in society today. And this is the aspiration of Generation Z. All children today are Generation Z. 72% of them want to be entrepreneurs. And they're on their way to becoming entrepreneurs. And they say, we are not here to make money. Money is incidental. We are here to make the world a better place. So that is the social / business entrepreneurship ambitions of our generation. Therefore, this demands greater partnership between parents and schools. I'll come to that a little later. And the third big shift that has taken place, and we can keep on arguing till we either win or lose the toss, online education is not a substitute for face-to-face education. Online education is not a substitute, it is an alternative, ladies and gentlemen. And I'll tell you why it is an alternative. In fact, the thinking in the world today amongst thought leaders is that the future of education is going to be digital education, starting from grade one onwards. Now all the technologists have a taste of blood. They know that in this pandemic, this is the area where they can make a lot of money. All artificial intelligence, all technology companies are now focusing on using virtual reality, augmented reality, how and blockchains as to how they can make this digital experience better and richer than face-to-face experience. It's going to happen. It's going to happen in our, not lifetime, next 3 to 4 years. Research shows us that children who are from online schools, they do better than offline schools. Far better. So it's an alternative form. It is an alternative form for two reasons. The greatest innovation in history has not been fire or the wheel. It has been the ability to read. Because human beings are not wired for reading, they are wired for speaking. Not wired for reading. So the reading track has to be developed by constant practice. So people who don't read, they are unable to develop their cognitive track. And the cognitive track, for very loose terms, they say the left side of the brain. So the left brain is the left track, and that has to be developed. So our ability to be a critical thinker depends a lot on the quantum of deep reading and non-fiction reading and reflection and introspection that we've been doing as a result of the left brain. So that is linear thinking. The right brain is non-linear thinking. It develops the creativity side because the plasma medium is such. The plasma medium is such. Our children are babies and children and chicks of the plasma world. We are immigrants, we are not natives. They are born like fish in water, they are. They are born and they swim in this plasma fluid. That is the right side of the brain, it's non-linear. You need both. You need ideas, creativity, with your right brain. And as an entrepreneur, you need the left brain to turn that idea into reality. There is a big difference between being creative and innovation. Most creative people are not innovators. Innovators have the ability to translate that into a real product, into a reality. For that, you need many other competencies, like grit, like resilience, ability to deal with failure, team playing, empathy, critical thinking. Big picture thinking. So you need a combination of left brain and right brain, and this is one of the reasons why in the last 73 years, our IITs and IIMs and premier companies have not been able to produce one life-altering innovation in the world. And this is not what Arjun Ray says, this is what the government of India says, this is what Narayan Murthy says, FICCI says, CII says. Little while back, the co-founder of Apple, Wozniak, he said, because our education system has only developed the head, the left side. It has ignored the right side completely. Therefore, even if tomorrow the sun breaks out and there is no corona in the world, blended learning is the new normal. You have to do blended learning. If you want to be an entrepreneur and you want to be an innovator. Because if you are not having an entrepreneurial mind, the future of our children is grim. They will not be able to reskill themselves. And reskilling today is a 24/7/365 exercise. So the people who are getting laid off, people not going to have any jobs, they will remain laid off, they'll remain jobless because they cannot reskill themselves. And there is a big thinking now that the artificial intelligence industry is not so much going to create new jobs. It will, whatever it is, do, it will do it so efficiently, there'll be fewer and fewer jobs available in the market. AI will do more of what it is doing now. And there'll be fewer and fewer jobs in the market. And millions of people trying to secure those jobs. So these are the three big shifts. The shift from education of the head only to education of the heart and the mind. Means the role of the teacher is to teach the child competencies, emotional competencies, and spiritual competencies. The redefinition of leadership as an entrepreneur. So when you call a new leader today, you ipso facto mean that he's an entrepreneur. It's not a title or a position he or she has. Person at the factory level could have great ideas, could be an innovator. And the third thing is blended learning is the future of learning because online is not a substitute, it is an alternative. So ladies and gentlemen, I feel my start point is this is a great thing that has happened. Took a corona to disrupt the existing education system. To make us realize that this shift had taken place 20 years, but we required a steroid. COVID-19 is the steroid that is driving this innovation. It is the disruptor. Now we know we can't survive. We have got our back to the wall. So let us look at the impact. We've talked of a VUCA world, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. We are now living in a VUCA plus world. VUCA comes and VUCA goes. So when the butterfly flaps its wings somewhere, thousands of miles away, a disaster strikes, a tornado strikes, but then it's over. After a week or two or three, it's over. Katrina is over. 2008 is over. Traitors coming down, over. We are back to business. But in VUCA plus, the uncertainty continues for months, for years. And what is this great uncertainty that we are talking about? It is climate collapse. If the world's temperatures, which are rising, cross 2 degrees Celsius, the situation will be hopeless. It will be irretrievable. COVID-19 is a dress rehearsal for us. It is a mock examination. It is preparing us that, listen, the bigger threat has already arrived at your doorstep. The wolf is there. The thief is plunging a dagger in your heart, and you can't say, I'm going to pull your coattails. Therefore, all workplaces, starting from our homes, to our offices, to our schools, to our universities, to our markets, are now war zones. This is what I call the Beirutization of society. We are all in a startup mode. Fortune 500 companies are in a startup mode now. Tomorrow, Facebook may collapse, Apple may collapse, Amazon may collapse. We can't take it for granted. Therefore, our children have to be startup ready, and schools have to be startup ready, teachers have to be startup ready, parents have to be startup ready. It's like Israel. Israel is a nation of startups. It's a startup nation. Military service is compulsory there. You see young men and women in the armed forces on a date or an evening out there, having dinner in a restaurant. They've got the automatic rifles on their table there. They go for a swim on the beach, the automatic rifle is in a locker on the beach. They go to university classes, the locker, automatic rifles are there on in their lockers there. Code word comes, in 4 hours they're into combat. In 4 hours they are into battle. They are startup ready. There is no analysis and paralysis about it. They just go. Whole nation is like that. In every house, in every government building, in every floor, there is a nuclear and chemical proof shelter. It's by order, you have to make it. You make a lovely villa somewhere or you have a house in Koregaon Park, you've got to have a bomb shelter there. Compulsory. Against proof against radiation and chemical attacks. And 7 days food inside and water. So as we have in hotels that in case of a fire, don't take the lift, go down the staircase. There at every floor, you got to rush into your bomb shelter. That is being startup ready. Therefore, to get 100 out of 100 in chemistry and maths in today's context by itself is meaningless. It's absolutely meaningless. The world couldn't care a damn what Arjun's qualifications are. They ask me or they will want to know from me, what have you done with those qualifications? Are you an innovator? If you are not, please go. We don't need you. Just because you've been in the general in the army doesn't mean that you're an innovator. We want to know whether you are an innovator or not. That is your CV today. Nobody's bothered about your Harvards and IITs today. 50% of all employees in the innovation side in trillion-dollar companies are school pass. And most of the top and the most famous people who are innovators are college dropouts. They did not complete their studies. It is Bill Gates, it is Mark Zuckerberg, or it is Steve Jobs. The list is endless. It is endless. The owners of Google, owners of Oracle, all college dropouts. They're not interested in it. They're only, if you're innovative, you got the job. So the second big impact which we are seeing now is the rate of obsolescence, which is scary, which is frightening. Everything is getting outdated. Jobs, medicine, economy, politics, education, leadership, the role of the teacher and the role of the parents. The role of the parents is getting outdated. The type of parenting our parents did for us is no longer valid. And maybe some of the parenting which we are doing pre-corona is not valid. It is not valid. Most of it is not valid. We need a new parenting style in the post-corona period. And if I'm given the opportunity at Indus, I will speak about it. What I feel is the new role of the parent. It's changing. And the only way to deal with obsolescence is to be creative and innovative. Rescale yourself. Unless you rescale yourself, unless you are adaptable, unless you are a lifelong learner, you cannot adapt to obsolescence. We have to be technology-minded. And there's a big difference in being science-minded and technology-minded. I am not science-minded. I will possibly fail a grade 9 paper in chemistry, physics, and maths, and biology. But where I'll score over everybody else is I am technology-minded. I know what technology is required, where it is to be applied, how it is to be applied, how it is to be evaluated. I don't waste my time in that black box. So that's where I get all these bright kids, the IITians and all those big calculators. I say, listen, this is where we got to do it. This is how the concept is. Why it is important? Now get cracking and make the black box for me. We have to be technology minded. Our children have to be coders. Coding is more important than learning English, Hindi, Marathi, Telugu, Russian, Japanese, whatever it is. Language is not the problem. Some of our best surgeons in our country today, they are not good communicators in any language. But they are the best surgeons. They save lives. We used to have this big hang-up ki iska accent nahi hai. Old boy accent nahi hai iska. It is immaterial. Most of the Americans, great innovators who speak, or the great leaders who speak, they don't speak with English accent. They speak with whatever is the accent, whichever country they came from. Kissinger spoke with a German accent, an Austrian accent. He didn't speak with the Yankee accent. So I think these are some of the things we need to take into account. And the third big impact is standardization. And very important for teachers to understand this and for parents to understand this. We are witnessing the walls of standardization are crumbling. Corona is ripping them apart, bringing them down. It's like the Berlin Wall coming down. We are seeing the end of standardization. Because standardization is the biggest enemy of innovation. And that means standardized education. So in a purely hypothetical term, if there are 25 kids in the class, you need 25 different strategies. You need 25 different plans. It can't be a one shoe fit all. How many people can do it today? Name it. Name one teacher you have served under who could personalize learning. Online helps you to personalize learning faster. Algorithms help you to quickly sort out the things which human teachers and human teacher minds cannot do it quickly. They can create homeworks which are age appropriate, interest appropriate, and level appropriate. So the homework which you get, Vishal, will be different to what Arjun Ray gets. Same class. So this personalization is happening. And we are now going to see the end of this command control system, titles, positions, hierarchies, and silos. Left arm does not know what the right one is doing. Right arm does not know what the left arm is doing. If a teacher of the primary years asks a teacher of a parent of a diploma or a teacher of diploma program over there, you will not be well received. Because I guard my territory like tigers mark their territory with urine. The male tiger will not allow any other male tigers to enter in their territory. 10 kilometers by 10 kilometers, 100 square kilometers. We mark our territory. We are upset if somebody asks us anything which is I am supposed to be the custodian of that domain. We are in the age of teams. We are in the age of networks. We are in the age of collaboration. Hierarchical models are gone. That's how government should function. That's how schools should function. And that's how families should function, functioning as team. Today, all the critical decisions of a child are taken by parents or grandparents. Which school, which curriculum? Which college, university after that? Whom to marry? When to start a family? All the critical decisions are being taken by somebody else. In this new post-pandemic world, this is not going to work, ladies and gentlemen. She has to be empowered. She has to exercise the choice on her own. Right or wrong? Therefore, student autonomy, when we talk of standardization, it comes to student autonomy. Standardization is only one way to skin a cat. Corona says, no, there are many ways, hundreds of ways to skin a cat. And the fourth thing, which is very, very important, and this also is a key role of a parent. I would like to remind parents that you are the first teacher. The teachers in the school are the second teachers. And society outside, the environment, is the third teacher. So we are now seeing a great symbiosis between teacher one and teacher two. Teacher one and teacher two. So child is a composite whole. I would like parents to read the poem by Khalil Gibran. Children, the famous American Lebanese philosopher. What's he doing? He says that your children are not your children. They come through you, but not from you. You don't possess them. You are stewards. So the role of parenting is now a stewardship. And that is also the role of a teacher who works in partnership with teacher one, with parent one. So teacher one and teacher two are stewards. So children have to be given autonomy. Without autonomy, inquisitiveness cannot be there. Imagination cannot be there. Choices to be exercised are not going to be there. So how are we expecting our children to be innovative? So the last big, there are many, I'm just focused on four. We are witnessing the greatest pandemic in the world today. 7.2 or 7.3 billion people who are participating in the greatest psychological experiment in human history. Since man broke away from a chimpanzee and became Homo sapiens. We need to develop two things in our children. But before we do that, we need to develop two things in ourselves. Jaisa Raja, Vaisi Praja. You can't expect your children to do that if you can't do that. We can keep hollering from the top of the rooftop to say, listen, child, you got to be innovative, you got to be innovative. It's not going to work. You have to be innovative first. It's like saying that I'm going to teach you maths, but I don't know maths. But I know what is maths is very important. The first is psychological immunity. And we're going to have more and more pandemics, second wave, third wave, and climate change is going to last till our great grandchild. If you are the first generation, your child is the second generation. Not only your grandchild, but your great-grandchild. So psychological immunity under conditions of lockdown, of isolation, of quarantine, of uncertainty, continued uncertainty, ambiguity. We don't know what's going to hell is happening. Fear of the contagion, it can come back. In fact, corona is more of fear than actual. In total Karnataka, I think about 365 people have died. And before corona, four people died every day in Bangalore on a two-wheeler, four-wheeler accident. We have to live with these things. We have to live with accidents on the road. Do we say that stop all vehicles moving from the road? Because three and a half or four people are dying every day? That happened. Or financial worries, you know, what is going to be my future? How am I going to manage all this? So we need psychological immunity. But a collateral to psychological immunity is cognitive immunity. More for the children also. Because psychological immunity and cognitive immunity, if parents don't have this, they will rub it off on their children. A stressed out father, a stressed out teacher will stress the children. That's what the children, they only children learn three ways. Role modeling. Example. So mummy and daddy are stressed out, the kid is stressed out. If teacher sir or teacher ma'am is stressed out, The student is also stressed out. We pass it on. So they're not genetic, they're called memes. In biology, biological transferring takes place through genes. But these information viruses, which media creates, and we run into a panic situation over there, I would call this cognitive immunity. Today, 70% is disinformation. WhatsApp, social media, internet, television, 70% is fake news or unauthenticated news. If not fake news, unauthenticated news. Fake news. How does a child distinguish between fake news and truth? Human hacking. Today, Google knows more about your and my thinking, our habits, everything. More than what we know about ourselves. Therefore, as I speak to you now, corporations and states have the ability to manipulate our thinking and to manipulate our behavior. They're doing it every single day. Whether it is buying books from Amazon, whether it is Brexit, whether it is Netflix, the type of movies you're watching over there, they'll keep on reminding you that, saying to you that, listen, we know what you're interested in. This, would you like to see this movie? Would you like to see that movie? And to manipulate our behavior. It happened in Brexit, it happened in the American elections, and it is happening in our country in a very big way. In every country it's happening. How do we prevent our brains to be hacked so that we act as responsible citizens? Cognitive immunity. Memory loss. In fact, what I am saying is now being used as a study to see how Parkinson, Alzheimer, and dementia can be handled. So those people, especially middle-aged plus people who have cognitive immunity will ever suffer victims of Parkinson, Alzheimer, and dementia. The protein plaques will not develop enough to cover their brain. Cognitive immunity. So, ladies and gentlemen, we should look at corona as something good that has happened. I don't know why it took God such a long, or Mother Nature took such a long time to send it down to us. It should happen a long time back. It is only through adversity that we can become stronger human beings, better human beings. It is only through adversity that we can evolve to a higher level, higher thinking level, higher emotional level. Remember what William Blake said, great things are done when men and mountains meet. This is not done by jostling in the street. Most of us are jostlers, tamash bean, spectators, onlookers in life. We're just jostling around our way through academics, way through our jobs, way through our life. It's only through adversity. Trial that you become creative and innovative and happy. Suffering ceases suffering the moment it finds meaning. We can therefore, ladies and gentlemen, turn a tragedy into a triumph. And Corona gives us that situation, that moment we have today. So what is this wartime leadership model we are talking about? Firstly, we have to be entrepreneurial minded. I explained to you the difference between an entrepreneur and a leader. So the new leader now, actually redefined leader means he's an entrepreneur or she's an entrepreneur. And to be future ready is to be startup ready. We, as parents and schools, have to work together in harmony, in unison, to ensure that our kid, when she passes out from in the Pune, she is startup ready. So what are we doing about it? We are beginning a startup school at Bangalore from grade 9 to grade 12. It's an experiment. It's free of cost. They will be selected after a very strict round of challenges. And the best brains in Bangalore, entrepreneurs, you know, Bangalore is the Silicon Valley, is the startup capital of India. Largest number of NRIs and people back from Silicon Valley. The best angel investors, the best venture capitalists, the best entrepreneurs, the most successful Silicon Valley stories. We'll prepare your kid to be an entrepreneur, including setting up business incubation centers for them. Grade 9. The race begins. And these 30 kids, when they graduate, will be startup ready. Parents in Bangalore and Hyderabad, and I'm going to talk to school and senior school tomorrow at Pune. These two schools, they have gone into an overdrive. And they have even said that include Hyderabad and Pune also. So we are seriously now thinking of having 30 kids from Pune and 30 kids from Hyderabad and 30 kids from Bangalore. And the team that works with me are Indus parents who have been very, very successful. Household names in Silicon Valley. And I will request parents of Pune to come forward. So if you're going to set up a startup school in Pune, then we would like Pune parents, Pune venture capitalists, Pune angel investors, Pune parents or entrepreneurs to be a part of this great experiment. I'm going to talk at length to the parents tomorrow about this, as to how they can help us out over there. This is now the new role of the parent. Teacher one and teacher two, both working together to make their child an entrepreneur. The role of a new parent. You're aware of our leadership school. You're aware of the leadership curriculum. But we believe that ethics is a very, very important aspect of human education today. In the age of AI, machine learning, bioengineering, blockchain, coding, virtual reality, augmented reality, in this new world, we require ethics. Therefore, we need to formally teach and see that the ethical dimensions of a child are upheld. So we're going to now have, from the next session onwards, the chief philosophy officer on my staff. And she is of the level of a principal. That is the importance we are giving to the ethical education of your child. We were in Israel recently in January, and the chief head of their space agency, who's also the head of the AI National Council, Entrepreneurial Council, who also teaches in the Tel Aviv University, he said that one of the main reasons why startups fail is because they are not ethical. And he said to me, General, please ensure that 30%, minimum 30% of your curriculum is ethics, ethics, ethics. That is why we score low marks. So a kid who's 100 out of 100 in science and math, but is not ethical, won't survive. A kid who is 70-70 or 60-60, but is ethical, will survive and will be innovative. So, ladies and gentlemen, the third big aspect about this is innovation, and I've spoken to you about this at great length, and I'm not going to hammer the point home again. So we are now going to the the whole aspect of personalization, the role of the teacher. So what we are now doing is that the teacher today is spending a good over 90% of her time away from your child. Parents today, the world are living in an illusion. You really think your teacher has got time for your child? We're kidding ourselves. She wants to, she can't. She has to prepare on average 4 lessons tomorrow morning. And she has to do it every year. She has to update it. This is the 32nd town hall I'm doing in the last fortnight. 32nd town hall. I've spoken to 6,000 parents. Generally, it is the same. But I come prepared to speak to you. Every talk of mine is different to the other talk. You can go to my website. The same talk I've given, which I give tomorrow, will be different to what I've given to you today. There will be basic structure is the same, but it will be updated, re-nuanced. I have to do it. I can't come unprepared in front of you. I can't appear unprepared in front of 21 kids laughing at me. She has formative assessments, summative assessments, homeworks, revisions, support classes, uploading marks, Indus Day, Sports Day, this day, that day. She has no time. So in Bangalore, we have introduced robots. They are big robots, adult robots. We made them here ourselves. They are first in the world. And you should go to History Channel to have a greater look into how these robots function. We're giving 5 to Pune. Next year, we're giving 5 to Hyderabad. Complete from grade 4 onwards, right up to grade 11. They take over this 90% repetitive and routine tasks. So the teacher now has got 90% of her time to spend with your child. Isn't that marvelous? This is the yantra and this is the mantra. This is called personalization of learning. AI takes over the responsibility. Therefore, the mantra is human intelligence plus artificial intelligence is equal to innovative intelligence. That is the magic we have created, and that is the magic we're going to create more and more. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude by urging you to look at COVID-19 as something that has saved humanity from disaster. Had COVID-19 not happened, we would have plowed on this furrow, this track, which right from the time of the innovation of the printing press, the Gutenberg printing press, we've been doing. Our schools in the world today are nothing but industrial age factories. Smokestack chimneys, theater-style seating, teacher talking, content in the front of the class, and unhappy faces in the audience. So the good that has happened. I would like you to look at Corona as a crucible experience. The biggest trigger for transformation is a crucible experience, a life-altering experience. It changes you. It's like an alchemist who puts all ordinary elements into that bowl, heats it up to a temperature, and ordinary metals become gold. Innovation is the only vaccine against COVID-19. It is the only vaccine against climate collapse. It is the only vaccine that is going to build antibodies in us to build up our psychological and our cognitive immunity in a world that's going crazy. It is the only vaccine that is going to make us happy. Because we will learn that if we give meaning to suffering, we can turn a tragedy into a triumph. It has given us time to press the pause button and spend time with ourselves. We never spend time with ourselves. It is a reminder that I am the most important person on this planet. I am the most important person on this planet because of Aham Brahmasmi. God is within me. The kingdoms of God are within me. That is the difference between a cockroach and a human being. Gods don't reside in the minds of a cockroach. They reside in you and me. Man is a manifestation of God. He's a child of God. Man is divine. And to be divine, we have to reconnect with ourselves. This is the pause button. This is the recentering in our Google map. It recenters us where we are and what route we should follow. Time to reflect, to introspect, to contemplate, to seek a higher goal in life. And something which is going to be a very big challenge in the not so far future. The amount of work is going to decrease. Our challenge will be, how do we live a life of purpose and meaning when the workload is left? How do we deal with it? What is pleasure? What is leisure? What is our understanding of leisure? Is there leisure enough? What do we do? Therefore, I would like each one of you to look at COVID-19. Something that's a great gift which Mother Nature has given to us. It is a dress rehearsal and a mock exam for the big examination that has already arrived. So I would like you to see another 3-4 months, the vaccines will come. All this big talk, when will school start and when will this happen, when will that thing happen, is all infectious talk. People are working overtime. In fact, the human trials, some have gone into third stage also now. And I think definitely by October to December, the vaccines will be out. Here you go. The bigger threat is there. Therefore, before I hand you over to ask questions and to Preeti, we are into a very close collaboration with Apollo Hospitals, and we have worked out a very elaborate back-to-school plan. Staggered plan. Staggered entry. Right from the time the child is picked up to the time the child is dropped. Not that I am sounding bumptious or arrogant about it, but I don't think any school has worked that out. Apollo is a very renowned hospital. And it's working in very, very close collaboration with another, with Jahangir in Pune over there. Have I got the name correct, Preeti? Jahangir Hospital?
That's right, sir. Jahangir, yes.
And they have worked out our safety protocols, health protocols. And their doctors and nurses will ensure on the campus that we stick to those protocols. Working with the government of India, with the Ministry of Health, they're advising the Ministry of Health. They worked out those protocols, and we are now just in the final phase of putting it together. It's a very expensive protocol. It involves a lot of expenses, but we are not going to charge parents one nap as a whole. We're going to bear those expenses. But the bottom line is clear: your child is safer on the campus than at home. How long are you going to keep your child under lockdown? He'll go crazy. He'll end up in hospital. He has to go out and play with people in the neighborhood. He's going to catch COVID-19. You can't supervise him everywhere. If he's on the campus, he's safe. And most of the time, from the time he's picked up to the time he's dropped, he's in the campus. and is being closely supervised by trained professionals who know their job. Pune will have a resident doctor. We already appointed a resident doctor. We already have one in Bangalore right from last 18 years. We got one in Hyderabad now. A team of nurses, they'll be trained again, retrained by Apollo. And Apollo doctors will be there, nurses will be there to see that the damn thing happens, including at the IELCs. Mostly never. If one child gets positive, it's a collective failure. It's our collective failure. We have to therefore over ensure that your child is safer than your gold in Fort Knox and your money in the Reserve Bank of India. If you keep him at home, you are risking, you're putting your child to risk. He's going to be all over the place. It's like, you know, you've been in prison for a long time. What is the big problem which your prisoners face who do 10, 15 years in jail? They have to relearn how to cross a road. They have to relearn everything. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, if there are any suggestions or comments or critique which you have, please be free to ask. I'll be delighted because you'll benefit others also. So, Preeti.